All right, this morning we are continuing along in our series of Acts, and we've been in Acts here for a little over a month. And if you're new or you're visiting here, kind of up to this point, the story of Acts is like a, well, the whole Bible is like a history book, but the story of Acts is specifically the history of our church. How did we expand? How did we grow? And not just Salem, but the worldwide church. So Acts, as we have got up to this point, is beginning to expand. And a lot of believers, literally by the thousands, are coming to know and accept the gospel message. So a lot of important things are going on, and we are going to pick up in Acts 5, verse 12. So we left off on 11 last week, if you weren't with us and you want to catch up. We stopped at verse 11. So listen now to the word of God. The apostles performed many signs and wonders among the people, and all the believers used to meet together in Solomon's colonnade. No one else dared to join them, even though they were highly regarded by the people. Nevertheless, more and more men and women believed in the Lord and were added to their number. As a result, people brought the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and mats so that at least Peter's shadow might fall on some of them as he passed by. Crowds gathered also from the towns around Jerusalem, bringing their sick and those tormented by impure spirits, and all of them were healed. Then the high priest and all of his associates, who were members of the party of the Sadducees, were filled with jealousy. They arrested the apostles and put them in public jail. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the doors of the jail and brought them out. "Go, stand in the temple courts," he said, "and tell the people all about this new life." At daybreak, they entered the temple courts, as they had been told, and began to teach the people. When the high priest and his associates arrived, they called together the Sanhedrin, the full assembly of the elders of Israel, and sent to the jail for the apostles. But on arriving at the jail, the officers did not find them there. So they went back and reported, "We found the jail securely locked, with the guards standing at the doors. But when we opened them, we found no one inside." On hearing this report, the captain of the temple guard and the chief priest were at a loss, wondering what this might lead to. Then someone came and said, "Look, the men you put in jail are standing in the temple courts teaching the people." At that, the captain went with his officers and brought the apostles. They did not use force, because they feared that the people would stone them. The apostles were brought in and made to appear before the Sanhedrin and to be questioned by the high priest. "We gave you strict orders not to teach this name," he said. "Yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood." Peter and the other apostles replied, "We must obey God rather than human beings. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead, whom you killed by hanging him on a cross. God exalted him to his own right hand as Prince and Savior, that he might bring Israel to repentance and forgive their sins. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." This is the word of God. So here again, we have the apostles up to, I wouldn't say no good, but they're up to some things that other people in the area had told them not to do. As you recall, just a couple of weeks ago, we talked about Peter and John who were out preaching and teaching, and they run across a lame man at the gates, and they heal him. They tell him to stand up. They tell the lame beggar to stand up, and he can walk, something he hasn't done since birth. And because of that, Peter and John are brought in to a very similar scene to this, and they're sat on there, but they couldn't be charged really with anything, so they're just kind of let go. And now, when they were let go, the Sanhedrin, the jurors, if you would, tell them, "Well, we're going to let you go, but no more preaching and teaching in the name of Jesus Christ. No more healing in the name of Jesus Christ." And Peter simply says, "No. We will always do that. We have seen what happened." And we will continue to do that. Now today, all these crowds are back in it, and everything's going on in it, and people are maybe just, they understand. It says that more and more are coming to believe, but they have a little fear in them. There's a little fear going on. Now, with all of this, Peter and the other apostles are still doing some pretty cool things. There's still some healing going on. There's obviously a lot of prayer, and there's obviously a lot of people coming to know the story of Jesus Christ, to believing in the story of Jesus Christ. So a lot of good things are happening, but there's still this little thing in the back of people's minds, this little spark of fear. So then the high priest gets wind that Peter and the apostles are still out preaching and teaching in the name of Jesus Christ. Things have been going pretty good, and obviously Peter and John and the others have went against what they had just got out or got off the hook for. So this time, as they're jailed, an angel of the Lord comes to them, and they're locked up, and the angel says, I'm going to set you free. Go and spread the word. So the next morning, or as the night progresses, they leave, they go out into the temple yard, and they do exactly that. And the high priest goes in to bring these guys out of their cell, and the door was locked, the guards are sitting there, and it's empty. Now, this had to have been maybe a confusing sight. At first, I imagine you'd want to say, well, the guards obviously let them out. You'd have to blame the guards. The door was locked. They had the key. Now it's empty. The guards are standing there. The door is still locked. But where are the apostles? So they hear this commotion going on out in the temple yards, and they go out there, and they see the apostles, and they rally them up, and it says they're scared of getting stoned. So obviously something was happening. People are obviously siding with the apostles, so no force was given on either side, and they come back to the courtyard, and they're put on trial. And the high priest says, hey guys, I thought we told you no more preaching and teaching and healing. And Peter, who I always laugh at Peter in the books of Acts, because it's like Peter always has to be that instigator, that spokesman. It's like I have a stepbrother, and he was always the one, like, you could totally be off the hook, like the fight was over, and then he would pipe up and either spill the beans about something else, or he would snap back and say something to my parents, and we'd always get in more trouble than we originally would have gotten. That's kind of maybe like what Peter's a little like. He's always got to put that little snippet in. Like, the first time, yeah, we got off the hook, but we're still going to go do whatever we want to do because God told us to. Now, they're standing on trial here again, and so they're saying, we told you not to do this. He says, but I have to obey God, not a human. So he's basically saying that what you say, what your law is, I don't care, because God is more. God is above you. God is above us. And Peter says, I will do whatever God tells me to do. No matter what your threats, no matter what your punishment is, that is what I am ordained to do. Then he says, you killed Jesus, and God raised him. Why would I follow you when I have God who raised Jesus? God raised him for me, for us, so we could all be forgiven, so we could go out and do the things that the apostles were doing. So of course we're going to go out and preach and teach and heal and do whatever else God tells us. So now I want to quickly summarize the parts that we didn't read. So in other words, after verse 32, what's going to happen and what's going on. So one of the Pharisees that are in the court stands up and he says, guys, we have to be very, very careful about what we do here, about how we sentence or punish them. Remember all these guys before who maybe got a big head, and they got kind of this little crew to follow them, and they tried to take over, and we crushed them down. Remember all that? Well, they did it because of their human desires. If we punish these guys in such a way, and they're doing this for God, nothing will stop them. If they're doing it for a human, they will surely be crushed, just like we have always done. But if they are truly doing it under God's will, under God's power, under God's direction, then nothing we can do will stop them. No matter what we do in this court, nothing will stop them. I'm a horrible language student. In other words, I didn't like Greek. I didn't like Hebrew. I didn't like Arabic. I didn't like Spanish. I definitely did not like English as well. I really strongly dislike learning languages. Now, it's not so much like, I think the words are fun, but it's all that like, when one word can mean the same, but then we throw a little letter, maybe it's an A or an O on the end of it, and then it means whether it's masculine or feminine, and then we can change an S and we can add an apostrophe, but sometimes we don't have to add an apostrophe, but if we want to pluralize it, sometimes we got to add an ES. I really dislike grammar and language. It's confusing for me. And not only that other languages around the world, as we try to learn them, or as I try to learn them, there are so many words that can mean literally the same thing and have tons and tons of different words for it. Or the opposite, one word can mean tons and tons of different things. There's a story called Against All Odds, a book. And this is about two FBI agents who have a complete... Anyone read this book, Against All Odds? I think there's actually maybe even a movie about it. Anyways, there's two FBI agents, and they have completely different concepts about love. Now, one agent believes love is restrictive. Now, a person who thinks love is restrictive would mean that love is the very thing that makes life difficult. So that's kind of the far one side of the spectrum. Love is restrictive. Now, the other person, the other FBI agent, believed that love was liberating. In other words, love gives us a sense of freedom. Now, that is an example of one word meaning two completely opposite things. One, love is restrictive. One, love is liberating. And as the story goes on, and this FBI, these two FBI directors, like the whole thing is based around how the opposite views of life are on the same concept, the same thing of love. And I mention that because if we look at our history, whether in the Bible or in our history books or whatever else we want to look at, if we look at the history of mankind, the exact same thing is happening. Some of us see love as liberating. And some of us view and see love as restricting. On Tuesday, this coming Tuesday, we have a holiday that is designed or was designed on one side of the spectrum. So like I said in the children's sermon, when we think of the word freedom or independence, it's this liberating kind of love. That we love each other enough to give you freedoms, to have freedoms, to respect one another enough to have their freedoms and have all kinds of these differences. See, freedom wasn't something that a group of men just came up with this word and we're just going to gather around and protect some concept of freedom, even though it's so vague and it's one word and it can mean a thousand different things. That's not what freedom was. So what truly is freedom then? If love is something that's restrictive and liberating and freedom is something that can be liberating, then how do we get love into freedom and how are we actually free? I want to read something that you all have heard. Hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. Everyone's probably heard that, or at least you should have. With that, something that we miss in there. Those words mean something very different today than what they were actually penned down or inked in to actually mean. Frankly, it continues my opinion that we as Americans have no idea what liberating freedom based upon love actually means. We have no idea what that actually means. It's a concept that was lost, that in this hold truths to be self-evident, that this paragraph or this sentences I just read have been totally lost. I look back at Independence Day, over the years that has progressed, the holiday in general that has progressed to be, and I frankly ask, what does it mean to protect our desires? What does that mean? How does this language come together to protect our desires? Now, everyone in here, whether the desire's good or bad, we all have desires. Does that mean that freedom that's liberating out of love is to protect all these desires no matter what I feel and no matter what I want to do, they're protected? No. That's simply not exactly what it means. I want to look back to chapter 4 of the book of Acts. Peter and John seem to only be the ones that were arrested in chapter 4. They're the only ones that were mentioned in this. Yet today, and in chapter 5, as 4 progressed into 5, we see all the apostles actually being arrested. Now that brings something important there. Peter and John kind of started this movement, right? And then all of a sudden now all the apostles are out preaching and teaching and healing. And then, all of a sudden, the guards and the members of the Sanhedrin are afraid of being stoned because something was happening. Something that we need to remember each and every Independence Day. See, set freedom isn't determined by circumstance. Let me say that again. Set freedoms is not determined by circumstance. We look at this cell that man had made. It's a thing. It's a tangible thing. Now God, who's way more powerful than any brick and mortar cell, sends angels to bust out the apostles so they could go and preach. Not so they could go live wild and crazy freedom-filled lives. So they could continue to proclaim the good news of Christ. The very thing that had got them back into jail. Now, for us today, many of us here have some sort of prison. You have that thing that enslaves you to do the exact opposite of what Peter and John and the other apostles were doing. We have these things in life that trap us down, that say, well, this is a pretty hard situation to get out of. And maybe for us, maybe that door, the cell door, is even unlocked. Maybe God has unlocked that door and you sit in the back of your cell saying, if I go out there, it could be dangerous. See, the apostles were faced with two things. They could either sit in there and be sorry for themselves, or they could have freedom. Now, not in the sense of the freedom that we are entitled to protect everything that goes through our mind, but they could have the freedom to truly protect what was right. In other words, the apostles were set free to go out and do the very same thing that sent them into jail. If you remember when Paul was in prison, they had to change the guard. This is later on, not now. They had to change the guards frequently because Paul would convert the guards. In other words, he would make them believers as they were watching over his cell. So the Romans had to frequently change the guards. This is found in the book of Matthew. Now, freedom isn't controlled by government. So if we look at this idea of liberating freedom through love, now we think, well, freedom has to be controlled by something. Well, freedom, true freedom, like the apostles are teaching us, is not controlled by the government. Think about that for a second. The apostles got thrown into jail by some form of the law or some form of the government. They got busted out by a higher power, by God, by the angel sent by God, and they go right back to doing the very same thing that they were sent to jail now for some of them, twice, and they're caught again, brought back, put on trial again, and later on, when I summarize that verse, they say, we're going to go right back out and keep doing this. Each and every time. No matter what you do, you cannot stop us. See, no matter what happened, the goal, the mission, the freedom that they had to do was not controlled by the government. Each time they got knocked down, they went back out and they did the same thing to protect that freedom. Each time that they had found themselves sitting in the back of the cell, they went to the door and said, "I don't care how I have to get out, let me find a way." Now, like I said, Peter, the one who cracks me up, is always that instigator, that one that says, "Hey, like, I'll get the last word in here." So he speaks up and he says, "Hey, y'all killed Jesus. He's back. He came back. I saw it. I witnessed it. That's not going to stop me. Bars, bricks aren't going to stop me. I'll convert the guards if we have to." That's freedom. That is true freedom. That nothing can stop you from achieving what you want. In our world, we are run by all these illusions, these things going on that we have deceptions and government, that we have, we are now victims of lies, of falsehoods, and that's true. That's true. We are victims of our own freedoms. Yet we, as Christians, ask the wrong questions. We sit back here and say, "Well, now what?" We ask, "Why does God let this happen to me? Why us?" Well, I ask you again, the title of this sermon, who should I obey then? The government or God? Now, I'm not saying go grab your pitchforks and your guns and let's revolt. But the bottom line here is a government doesn't set what freedom is. A government can possibly protect a freedom. But ultimately, what God does and what God is doing is what freedom is. Yet we as a Christians, we become something that stands between truth and logic. Jesus himself said, "Blessed are those who are persecuted," in Matthew. Blessed are those who are persecuted. Yet we as Christians are afraid to be persecuted because we believe. Jesus himself said that. We're afraid of labels. We're afraid that if we stand up for our freedoms, if we stand up for our beliefs, that we're going to then get a label that we're some kind of, like the 90s song, we're some kind of Jesus freak. We're afraid of those labels. We don't want to lose our degree of coolness. I always get a kick out of it, and the kids that are going out to Rocky, you'll experience this. Especially, so if you don't know, we're going with the Sioux Falls kids, and they're trouble. They're riding the bus with us, and I know them well. And you'll see this out of the Sioux Falls kids, not the Little Rock kids, but they will experience something at church camp, and they will load that bus to come back home, and they will be on fire for Christ. But a week later, when y'all are at basketball camp or volleyball camp or cheer camp, and that degree of coolness now is separated by Christians and non-believers, and all of a sudden it's not really cool to be throwing your hands up and saying praise Jesus when you're at basketball camp. See, we as Christians have the freedom to do that, yet we're afraid of that label. We lose a degree of freedom. We watch the freedoms that we're so boldly saying, "Oh, I protect, I stand for these freedoms," yet we watch them go by us and never say a word. There's no doubt these times are tough. They're tough, and it's getting even tougher to stand up for what we truly believe in, yet it is our job as a church to take that stance, just like the apostles did. To say, no matter what cell you throw me in, no matter what labels you give me, I will stand up and preach and proclaim the name of Jesus Christ. That is where we find real freedom that is liberating out of love. That is where we see Jesus Christ. When we believe in him, when we enter into relationship and fellowship with other believers, where we go out and talk to non-believers and say, "This is something bigger. This is a freedom way bigger than anything in any document that was ever written, aside from the Bible." This is bigger than any constitution, any amendment that was ever written. This is freedom. And then when we say, world, you can beat me down, you can throw me in jail, you can flog me, you can throw rocks at me, I don't care, because I will still stand up and proclaim the name of Jesus Christ. And when you say, I am a son, I am a daughter of God, and nothing can stop me, that is when we have now experienced the love of Christ that sets us free. That is when we are truly free. Would you pray with me? Our Father, I ask that you be with us. Help us see this game that we're playing, this business of playing Christian. Help us to stop just playing church, to stop making this religious show or episode that we put on once a week, but to understand that there are relationships of which we enter when we say, I am a believer, that we tie into with a living God. You are the God that changes the world around us. This event of this day, this hour, tomorrow, the whole week. These events won't be reflected in newspapers. There'll be no headlines saying, believers come to Christ, that Salem Reform has baptisms. There'll be no headline come Tuesday morning saying, we as believers are free. We're so thankful for that, that we truly know that we are the salt of the earth. We are the light of the world. And I pray that we begin to act that way again. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Next Sunday, here at Salem, we will be practicing one of our two. Actually, we get both sacraments next Sunday. That's exciting. We have a baptism, and we'll be celebrating the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. Now, here at Salem and the Reformed Church, we do what we call a preparatory service. Now, the preparatory service has kind of evolved throughout the years of the RCA, and different churches still use it and some don't. But I find it important, and this is something that as elders we're trying to work on, to say, hey, we as elders need to be better at this as well. That we as elders and pastor and deacons as well need to reach out to you guys more and make sure that as you come to this table, you are in the right position. And that is what the preparatory service actually is. It's a time for us to say, God, over the next week, help me examine my life. Help me see the things that I am sinning against. Help me see the areas I fall short. And Father, let me approach this table knowing that I am a sinner. That nothing I eat or drink at this table is truly my salvation, but Jesus Christ is. So as we look into our lives, and we're going to pray here in a second, and in my prayer, I'm going to go silent. It's kind of that awkward, like, silent part of the prayer where everyone's sitting there looking at your neighbors, wondering if they're still praying for all the sins, and maybe you only have 5 seconds of sins, and some of you, like me, maybe have 2 minutes of sins, but I'm going to give you, like, 30 seconds. So pour out your hearts however long it takes. Just spend time and say, God, I got so much going on in my life. That things inside of me are tearing apart. I have hate. I have thoughts. I have lust. Whatever's going on in your life, pour it out and don't be afraid. Because God, like I said in my prayer to start the service, He truly knows what's in here. So would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for the sacrament you have passed on to us. That somewhere in the midst of a meal that we partake in, of fellowship with one another, that we are led to the cross. That in this bread and cup that we'll partake in next week, that we are examined as Christians, that we reveal to you, and that we celebrate together what you have given us. Heavenly Father, I come to you knowing that I have sinned, that we have sinned. As a community, we have sinned against you and we have sinned against one another. In both words and actions, we do this each and every day. Therefore, Father, I ask that you look at what we have done and what we leave undone. And let us pray in silence before you this morning. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Amen. I'm going to read to you from 2 Corinthians here in closing. A gracious God forgives you and your sin, strengthens you by the Holy Spirit, and will keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. So if anyone is in Christ, there is new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has indeed become new. All of this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. Amen. Our final song this morning, if you don't know this song, it's one of my and my wife's favorites. It's kind of a new remake on Amazing Grace. We've sang it here several times, but if you're new here, if you're visiting with us, and you know the kind of the tune of Amazing Grace, you'll get it. So I invite you to stand, and let's just praise the Lord. Sing as loud as you can. I know we're a little short on numbers because people are hanging out on the beach and doing 4th of July firecrackers and will come with burns on their hands next week. So let's make up for them and sing with me.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised my hope secures. He will my shield and portion me as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my forbear to shine.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and offer you grace. May he look at you and give you peace today, tomorrow, and always. Have a good 4th of July week, everyone. Go in peace. Amen.